teeth, the water, danger. I always associate a shark as being quite a dangerous animal.
Big teeth. Long, with a sharp tail, and small eyes.
It's a general fear.
Yeah, I'm scared. Don't want to be in the sea with them at all.
North Cornwall's rugged and beautiful coastline, which for decades has been a popular holiday destination. The number of those enjoying our inshore marine environment has increased dramatically. Surfing, angling, leisure boating, diving, kayaking, windsurfing and others are all pursuits enjoying massive and increasing popular appeal. The widespread use of wetsuits means more people spending more time in and on the water. And this has resulted in regular sightings of sharks being reported from all around our coasts. These never fail to make headlines because most Britons believe that our waters are shark-free. Names like Mako, Great White, Tiger and Bull Shark send shivers down the spines of many of us. Sharks seem to hit three basic human fear buttons: the fear of being eaten alive, the fear of being out of your natural environment, and the fear of the unknown. What could be more chilling than suspecting a hidden monster might be lurking beneath you when swimming? Truly terrifying stuff, and the first Jaws film hit all three of these human fear buttons in its first few minutes. As far as most Britons are concerned, the images you are watching might as well have come from another planet in terms of their relevance to our islands. Our film will change this. I'm going to take you on a tour around the country and introduce you to some fellow residents whose presence may come as a surprise. Prey and predator has been the relationship of the blue shark to man through history, and our film explores which was which. Now, cage diving has given this shark a new eco-tourism future. Times are changing. The giant basking shark was in the past hunted by man and tragically once caused human deaths. Researchers believe this previously unshown footage may, for the first time, show courtship behavior. Also known as the lesser spotted dogfish, the small spotted cat shark can breathe while stationary by pumping water through its gills. We'll search for spur dog sharks in a Scottish sea loch, for hound sharks, and find out how the soupfin shark got its name. We'll take a new look at an old story, the puzzle of whether the dreaded great white shark visits Britain's shores, and we'll journey to the Isle of Wight with an angling party in pursuit of the elusive thresher shark. The poor beagle is a closely related, smaller version of the great white, although the world record poor beagle caught in Britain weighed a massive 36 stone. Our film has some of the best poor beagle footage yet shot anywhere. The search for our sharks took us the length and breadth of Britain, the private world of cat sharks, the one-time hunting of basking sharks, the tragedy of shark-caused human deaths, and today's drama of who eats who are all explored in our quest. You will never before have been on a journey like this as we bring you face to face with sharks in British seas. The blue shark gets its name from its striking, almost electric blue coloured topside. This is a slim, graceful shark, distinguished by its large pectoral fins and its almost snake-like movements.
The blue shark is a summer visitor to our shores and turns up each year in June, July, when the water temperature has gone above 14 degrees. This is one of the most wide-ranging sharks. Blue sharks caught and tagged off Britain and Ireland have regularly been later identified in the South Atlantic and in the West Atlantic off North America. Lou has a long association with the blue shark. It really is a picture postcard fishing town, which is one of Cornwall's most popular tourist centres. The town's association with sharks, and in particular with blue sharks, goes back 60 years to the start of shark angling. Indeed, Lou's reputation as the centre for shark angling has been one of its most enduring attractions. Mally Toms is an old friend and master of the Joe Dan. He's one of Lou's most experienced shark angling skippers, and there's no one better qualified than Mally to tell us about Lou's history.
Well, I think the whole town has revolved around shark fishing. For many years, there were only a few boats at it, and then they built up to a fleet of around about 24 at one time. And that was...
That was the heyday, I suppose.
That was about the heyday of it, yes, about 24 boats.
So this is part of Lou's history. Is it a valuable part of Lou's economy?
An enormous part of Lou's economy, without a shadow of doubt. Unfortunately, we've lost a few boats now. We're down to 10 boats now. But even so, there's still activity with other boating and what have you in Lou, again brought up by sharking.
And there was a pilchard fleet at one time.
Yeah, which obviously played a huge part in the keeping of the sharks in areas. When you had 24 boats going out on a daily basis, that rubby-dubby, which is the bag full of chopped-up pilchards, meshed-up pilchards, would create a very oily slick. And with 24 boats in quite a small area, that slick would stay there for days. They didn't have to go so far then. The sharks were closer in. Now we have to go between 15 and 20 mile looking for a shark, but years ago they were in a lot closer.
Is it still just as exciting when that reel goes off?
Absolutely, Richard. When it goes click, 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 I don't know whether it's going to be a big mako or it's going to be a little 30-pound blue shark. I've no idea whatsoever. Everybody thinks a shark's got to go whizzing off at a huge speed. Not true. Lots of times it's the slow click, click, click as the fish is just moving along and gradually start accelerating. And that's the big one. You just do not know when it goes click.
The Shark Angling Club of Great Britain was founded 55 years ago in 1953. The club's headquarters are on the quay here in Lou. The pictures tell their story, a story of mako sharks, blue sharks, and of a time when the sharks caught were all killed and brought back to the quayside to be weighed. This no longer happens. All club-caught sharks are now released. Tony Pym is a past chairman of the club and one of its longest-serving members.
I went shark fishing for several years, caught several sharks, before I caught a qualifying fish, which, as you know, has got to be 75 pounds or above. And then I joined in 69, so that's 38 years I've been, 39 years.
And how has Lou and shark angling changed in the time that you've been involved in the club?
Well, in the early days, as I say, you used to go out and you guaranteed to catch three or four sharks every time you went. Obviously, they've declined seriously in the last few years, certainly the last 10 or 15 years they've gone down quite rapidly.
So you've gone from how many thousand to how many hundred now?
Well, from, say, 2,000 to 3,000, almost guaranteed, down to perhaps 200, 150 to 200 now, yeah.
That's a really dramatic drop,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes.
Blue shark numbers are now greatly reduced, but human appetite for wildlife encounters increases all the time. Wildlife only has a secure future when it pays. I have travelled the world as a shark researcher and as an ecotourist, and I've seen it. If it pays, it stays. Shark cage diving is a popular pastime in South Africa and other places, and I could see no reason why it wouldn't work in Britain. Over 2,000 people applied for the 72 places on our pilot project. We have now been running blue shark cage diving trips off Cornwall for 3 years and have been successful in attracting sharks 65% of the time. You don't find sharks, they find you. And to help them do this, we lay a scent trail in the water. Mashed up mackerel, mixed with bran flakes, is put in a bag and hung over the side of the boat. The oily slick stays on the surface, and the bits of bran and fish sink down through the water column. The mixture is known as chum in most of the world, but in Australia they call it burley, and here in Cornwall, its name is rubby dubby. The cage is in the water, the rubby dubby has begun its work. Now we need a shark to come and visit us. We draw lots to decide the order people go into the cage. Most times we first see the shark when it arrives to investigate the bait tube and its fins break the surface. I can feel everybody's excitement as the first pair kit up and get ready to enter the cage.
Coming on the bait tube now, then get okay. Ready. One, two, go, straight ahead, look ahead.
We have to keep our shark interested and need a way to draw the animal close to the cage to give our divers a close-up view. We use a bait tube filled with chum. The shark can smell it and tries to mouth it as we draw the tube slowly towards the cage. Using this method, we have some influence over our shark as long as it stays interested. I've never yet had anyone who failed to enjoy meeting their first shark.
Oh, brilliant.
Sometimes the sharks don't stay long enough to give everyone a turn in the cage, but there will have been plenty of opportunity to watch the sharks from the boat, so everyone sees sharks one way or another.
Short tank, Chris. Hey, Shane. There's some halfway between me and you now, just off your starboard bow.
Lovely, thank you.
Dolphins are wonderful to watch and are a real bonus on a shark day as long as they don't gate crash the party while the sharks are still with us. The sharks always disappear when dolphins arrive, so I was grateful they decided to escort us back in rather than come and play earlier. The end of a magical day is always sad, but 10 very happy people have had an experience they will never forget and have joined the ever-growing shark fan club. Back in harbour, and the shark's 10 new friends disperse and will spread the word that perhaps sharks aren't such bad guys after all. The Highlands of Scotland, one of the few true wilderness areas left in Europe. Dramatic, rugged, beautiful, and home to a rich variety of wildlife. This is certainly one of the best places to see the second largest fish in the world, the basking shark. This giant plankton feeder occurs all round our coasts, but is most common along our western shores, Cornwall, the Isle of Man, and the Hebrides are all summer haunts for our largest shark. Reaching lengths of up to 10 metres and weighing as much as 6 or 7 tonnes, this shark is impressive by any standards. When I'm in the water with basking sharks and I see that huge open mouth coming towards me, I always hope they have remembered they are just harmless plankton eaters. We know very little about basking sharks. We're not sure how often they have pups or how many are in an average litter, although there is a reliable report of a litter of 6. They're often seen breaching or jumping clear of the water. They are highly migratory, and recent research has shown they cover great distances. Although Britain is one of the best places to see them, they are found all over the world in temperate seas. Peaceful images are a direct contrast to the violent mayhem that often occurred in the past when man met basking sharks. Mallaig is mainland Britain's most westerly harbour, and its history is a cycle of boom and bust. The sea has always provided Mallaig with its living, and the success or failure of the herring boats meant feast or famine for Mallaig's residents. Was also known as the silver darling, and when abundant provided a bonanza. During lean herring times, when other revenue sources had to be found, attention often turned to the basking shark, the sale of its liver oil also providing rich pickings. Mallaig's Heritage Centre tells the story of the town's fishing past. Here I found a gruesome relic from the days of basking shark hunting. This hefty harpoon with its folding out barbs was fired into the sharks. It's a fearsome object, and even an 8-meter basking shark would have known all about it when it got this in its back. The sharks often dive for the bottom on being hit, and they only rarely escape their captors once harpooned. As they were with whaling ships, the harpoons were mounted in the bows. As soon as the telltale sight of a fin broke the surface, the crews rushed to their stations and the gunner made ready. Once harpooned, an epic struggle began. After losing the battle, the dead shark would then be hauled back to the catching boat. Large 5 to 8 meter sharks fighting for their lives presented dangers, and the crewmen had to be careful. Injury was part and parcel of this messy job, and in those days there was no nearby accident and emergency facility. The dead shark was lashed to the side of the boat, and the liver was often cut out with the carcass still in the water. What today may seem a barbaric practice was common yesterday. And we should try not to judge past actions in the light of present day standards. The island of Soy near Maleg was the base of Gavin Maxwell, who later became a well-known author. Maxwell's great rival was Anthony Watkins, who had his base here, near Carradale on the Kintyre Peninsula. The remains of this boiler and tank are all that is left of the Watkins factory. The carcasses were floated in and butchered on this beach, and the livers were then carried to the factory to be rendered for their oil. All I can hear on this tranquil beach today is the quiet lapping of the water. When this factory was working, the scene would have been noisy, smelly chaos. Knives flashing in the sunlight, shouted orders, the cursing and swearing of hard-working men doing a dirty job, and the all-pervading stench of raw and rotting flesh. Across the water from Arran, Carradale is less than half a mile along the beach from the factory. And next to Carradale is Port Rhee. This lovely little bay has a tragic claim to fame. Alan Oman told us of the event, which was watched from the shore by his cousin Colin.
Well, the boat was coming round the point at Port Rhee Bay, and there was several men and several children in the boat, and all of a sudden a shark came up below the boat and overturned the boat, and there was two men lost and a child that day. I'm sure it was just pure coincidence that the shark had surfaced, but it may have come up to scratch itself to get sea lice, etc., off, barnacles off it. There were a lot of different theories at the time, but the boat lay over it behind that wall when I was growing up, and nobody would go out in it because it was considered unlucky until it rotted and it was burned.
The incident has haunted this community ever since. A million to one piece of bad luck caused Angus Brown, his son Neil, and his brother Robert to lose their lives by drowning. Colin Speedy is one of Britain's leading basking shark researchers and conservationists. I caught up with him aboard his yacht, which he has had purpose-built to sail around the world in. I hope the camera stays off me or it'll show my face green with envy. Scientists are starting to fill the yawning gaps in our basking shark knowledge, and Colin briefed me on recent discoveries.
I would say in the last 10 years we've learnt more than we have in the last 1,000 years. Certainly from the point of view of identifying some of the key sites where the sharks are most consistently seen at the surface, which has been very useful because it helps us to isolate and identify what threats may exist in that area where they are at their most vulnerable. And also, certainly too, the other area has been satellite tagging, which has been able to give us an insight into what they do out of season and when we're not looking, which is quite remarkable. So we've learned, for example, that some of the sharks that have been tagged in Scotland have made a southward migration, if you can call it a migration. Some of the ones which have been tagged in the English Channel headed north, up around the west of Ireland, out into deep water. So we do know now, for example, that they don't hibernate. They don't go off and snooze on the bottom somewhere, as was suggested in the past. There were some pretty bizarre ideas. And also, too, and most fascinatingly, very recently, Morvis Gore's study, where she was looking at tag charts from the Isle of Man, one of which made the migration all the way across the Atlantic and drive down to about 1,250 metres, which is phenomenal. So we now know, for example, that the basking shark won't just migrate in and around our locality, but actually can make an ocean basin movement, which is staggering stuff. We never had any idea of that before.
Colin has been working on a photo ID program for many years, and the results are now being assessed. Like a human fingerprint, the side-on view of a basking shark's dorsal fin can be a reliable identity guide. While working on his photo ID project, Colin shot this remarkable footage, which certainly seems to show sharks following each other, and he believes may be courtship behaviour. He could be right. And as far as he knows, this is the only such footage in existence. If it is, Colin has been privileged to witness and record a sight which must only rarely have been seen by man. This elaborate, graceful dance must have a purpose, as they're not feeding. Scientific knowledge on basking sharks has recently come a long way, but we still know relatively little about them. If this clip shows what it seems to show, it could be the beginning of unlocking another shark mystery. The Scottish Highlands provide some of Britain's best wildlife viewing opportunities. Tobermory on the Isle of Mull in the Hebrides is a centre for operators running trips to watch marine wildlife. An enormous diversity of creatures inhabit these islands and the waters that surround them. Common and grey seals, otters, puffins, gannets, dolphins, porpoises, orcas and minke whales, sea eagles, golden eagles, sunfish and basking sharks are all regularly seen in this area at the right time of year. Researchers deploy and haul in a plankton net to see what's present in the water. Not very appetizing looking for us, but if you're a basking shark, that's pretty scrummy stuff. Binoculars scan the water, looking for that distinctive fin. It's a very young shark close to shore, probably about a metre and a half long, and maybe a this year's pup, which is already the length of an adult human. Just think, this shark could end up over five times this size. Common and grey seals are often seen, and many times seals' heads are mistaken for dorsal fins. Wow, this is no seal's head, it's a dorsal fin. This shark is maybe 6-7 meters long. In the old days, it would have been a valuable catch for the hunters. Today, it's a valuable catch for photographers and filmmakers. Basking sharks and humans have long marched through time together. I've swum with them for years, but this visit to Scotland has shown me a new human side to their story. The hunters and the hunted. It's all within living memory. The tragic accidental deaths. And today's harmony, now that this gentle giant is protected in British waters. When you can reach 10 meters in length, you've got a lot to live up to. The basking shark does it with ease. St. Bride's Bay in Wales neighbours the Skomer Marine Reserve, and this is about as far west as you can get on the Welsh mainland. In Scotland, we track the giant 10-metre basking shark. We've come to this wonderful, sheltered, shallow bay to look for our smallest shark. You don't need the scuba tanks, cameras, and piles of equipment that we carry to see this shark. A pair of eyes, a mask, snorkel, and fins are all that you need to go and look for them from the beach. This little shark shares its home with a host of other fish, with lobsters, starfish, anemones, with mollusks, small crustaceans, and with crabs. Also known as the lesser spotted dogfish, the small spotted cat shark is a stunningly beautiful creature. This is one of our most commonly sighted small sharks and is present throughout British waters. Many shark skates and rays produce their young via egg cases, and this shark is one of them. Egg cases are deposited onto seaweed and commonly take 8 to 9 months to hatch. Not all sharks have to keep moving to breathe, and this one doesn't. This shark can remain stationary, pumping water through its gills. Shark is a big word. It applies to tiger and great white sharks, which have been known to attack man. The same name also applies to this little chap. It's a real shark, but it doesn't look too threatening, does it? Unlike many British sharks which are listed as threatened, the small spotted cat shark population is stable because there are no targeted fishing pressures. Back in the Westland Highlands, we drove past the Scottish Sea Life Sanctuary outside Oban, where curiosity got the better of us, so we called in. We couldn't resist the temptation to get the cameras out and film their smoothhound and starry smoothhound sharks. Both of these sharks grow to around a metre and a half and are present in many places around our coasts. The starry smoothhound is easily distinguished from the smoothhound by the spots or stars on its back or dorsal side. These sharks feed on crustaceans and have flat, crushing teeth, perfectly adapted for this shellfish diet. They do well in captivity and have been known to breed in aquariums, producing litters of up to 15 pups. I was happy to see that these smoothhounds showed none of the stress behaviour sometimes seen with captive sharks. And on to Loch Etive to keep an appointment with the spurdog shark. Loch Etive is a sea loch, and these deep, peaceful waters meet the sea at Northern Europe's only saltwater waterfall. We've joined Ronnie Campbell and an angling party who are confident they can introduce us to what was once our most abundant shark. These waters are deep and mysterious, and thoughts of monsters that live in lochs come readily to mind. The spurdog is also known as the spiny dogfish, the piked dogfish, and the doggy. We didn't come across any big specimens, but spur dogs will grow up to 2 meters, over 6 foot in length. We were really lucky. Our angling friends caught and released over 50 spur dogs in a few hours. The local abundance is misleading, as this is probably our most overfished shark. Researchers believe spur dog numbers are less than 5% of what they once were. The names piked and spiny come from the sharp spike located by the dorsal fin. To avoid getting stabbed, care must be taken when handling and releasing the spurdog. Time to get wet, and frankly, this treacle, tea-coloured cold water is about as appealing as a mud bath. The anglers will hand the sharks to me and I'll release them, hoping that we can get some shots before they disappear into the gloom. This shark charged the camera on release and stunned itself. I tapped it and off it went, seemingly perfectly all right. The locals believe that this mottled colouring on the underside denotes a resident population, and research is now underway to test this theory. Next stop is the Shark Trust in Plymouth to discuss just how much trouble spur dogs are in. The Shark Trust was founded in 1997 and is the only UK charity solely dedicated to the welfare of sharks and other members of their extended family. Its opinions and arguments are based on fact and science, and its voice is listened to all over the world. The Trust is a leading member of the Shark Alliance, and campaigning for a future for the spur dog is among its current priorities. I have been chairman of the Trust for the last 5 years and went there to get a briefing on spur dogs from Ali Hood, our Director of Conservation.
Spur dog were one of the most abundant sharks in the world, and as they're easily caught, they were a good target for consumption. Within the UK, they're used primarily within the fish and chip trade as under the name of rock salmon, or also sold under flake, huss, and a variety of other white fish names.
Are all the things described by the word rock sharks, or is it a more
sort of, you know, wider description?
It's difficult to tell, and I think in most cases you probably are consuming shark and probably are consuming spur dog if you buy something under that trade name.
Armed with an umbrella and my camcorder, I went to my local fish and chip shops to find out if people do know what they're eating.
If you buy rock salmon, do you know what sort of fish that is?
Not really, no.
Rock salmon? No.
I don't think I do know what it is, no. I
presume a type of salmon, but I've never tried it personally.
I haven't got a clue, really. Unless salmon is on rocks, I don't know.
No, I haven't the faintest idea. I presume it's some sort of salmon.
If I told you that it wasn't salmon at all, it was actually shark, would that surprise you?
Yes, would.
And if it was written on the wall as shark instead of salmon, would you be more or less likely to buy it?
Less likely.
Why?
Well, I've never eaten a shark, and at least I didn't think I'd eaten a shark.
But now you realise you might have done.
Yes.
Who eats who? Well, occasionally, and mostly by mistake, sharks do kill humans. On average, globally, there are less than 10 shark-caused human deaths a year, while man is killing up to 100 million sharks annually, pushing many species towards extinction. The main reason for the massive depletions in shark populations is the enormous and growing demand from China and Southeast Asia for shark's fin soup. Chinatown is a centre of Chinese culture in Britain. It seemed a logical place to look for evidence of the trade in fins and the sale of soup. We tried to film fins on sale in supermarkets and were pushed out of the shops. Suspicious, unfriendly eyes watched when we filmed menus. Eating shark's fin soup has been part of China's culture for hundreds of years. But it's only recently that demand has reached a level that threatens the very existence of many sharks. Finning is a hugely wasteful practice, and finning live sharks is cruel and abhorrent. In all man's abuses of the animal kingdom, the mass slaughter of sharks for the sake of bowls of soup must rank at the top of our shame list. The soup fin shark is both appropriately and unfortunately named. Also known as the tope, school, vitamin, and oil shark, the soup fin is present in most of our waters. This footage was shot in Southern California during a time of the year they come close to popular dive sites. Our first efforts to film soup fins off Cornwall in July were thwarted by the weather. So in September, we went to Bridlington in East Yorkshire, where they can occur in numbers at that time of the year. Bad weather caught up with us again, scuppering our plans for in-water filming. Nevertheless, I was lucky to catch up with Yorkshireman Nigel Proctor, who told me what species are found off Yorkshire's coast.
We have the lesser spotted dogfish, which are common. There's the smoothhound, there's the tope or the soup fin shark, which again is relatively common. Less frequently, we see basking sharks. There was an 800-pound thresher caught in a gill net very close to the shore, just 10 miles further north from this location. And of course, we get paw beagles.
Nigel, tell me sort of a potted history of the angling for soup fin, for tope sharks on the Yorkshire coast. How long has it been going on? How much is going on now, etc.?
Soup fin shark, we think, has always been caught irregularly along the Yorkshire coast for probably the last 25 to 30 years. It was only in 2000 that one or two anglers within the area began to target the species intermittently. Prior to that, as I say, there hadn't been an awful lot of directed angling, but it was more occasional bycatch. Since one or two anglers started around 2000, the catches started to increase significantly as effort increased. Other anglers began to see that the soup fin was a viable target species. And then around 2004, there were probably around 8 or 9 private vessels targeting the species.
And what's the biggest soup fin shark you personally have ever seen?
The biggest that I've seen is over 80 pounds. We have had them up to £75 on the boat, but an 80-pound silkfin shark is well in excess of six and a half foot.
It was with some sadness that we left Yorkshire and said goodbye for this year to our hopes of filming soupfin sharks. Nigel mentioned soupfin sharks growing to 6 feet in length. The North Sea is home to many, even larger sharks. Several hundred miles away in Scotland's North Sea, a large mystery predatory shark turned up in a fisherman's net in December 2003. I showed this photo to leading white shark experts. They all agreed it could be a great white. And if I had told them the location was South Africa, California, or South Australia instead of Scotland, a great white would have been their first choice. I have investigated over 70 reports from people claiming to have seen great white sharks in British waters. Seven of these incidents remain credible following further investigation. The earliest of the credible incidents involved a large shark spy hopping off Loo in South Cornwall in July 1970. John Reynolds is a highly experienced shark angling skipper. He had never seen a shark like this before.
Well, I say, we were sharking about July, August time, and well, it was after blue sharks, and we didn't have any by 3:30. By 3:45, we was ready to come home. I walked back to the back of the boat, lifted up the bag, what we call the rubby-dubby, and this, well, huge shark come up and looked at me. I thought, God, what's that, you know?
In late August 1999, there occurred a series of incidents off North Cornwall involving a large shark. Three incidents occurring in the same area, 10 witnesses, all in a short period, and with all the witnesses agreeing on the description. I believe all three incidents involved the same shark, and no previous televisual account has linked the incidents in order. All 10 witnesses describe a great white shark. A party of six aboard the Padstow-based Blue Fox were fishing for Paul Beagle and soupfin sharks off Crackington Haven. A large shark, estimated at 15 foot, cruised slowly past the boat's stern. The skipper Phil Britz, his wife Rona, and all those aboard know their sharks. This was not a shark they had seen before. In fact, the only one who could identify the shark was Phil's partner Mike Turner, who is familiar with great whites, having spent many years as a commercial fisherman in South Africa. Mike knew he had seen a great white shark. The next day, Paul Vincent from Bude was fishing for soupfin sharks in the same place when he got the shock of his life.
I was out fishing for tope, as I often do when I get the chance, with a friend of mine, Jason, aboard my boat at that time, which was a 17-foot dory. It was a nice sunny day, sea was calm, we hooked into quite a few during the day. I hooked into then what I thought was quite a big tope. I was proceeded to play it to the side of the boat. As I got it to the side of the boat, my friend Jason leaned over to grab it to bring it on board. All of a sudden he jumped back quick, swearing profusely. I leaned forward to see what the fuss was about, and as I leaned forward I saw this huge shark, at least the length of my boat, I would have said, swimming alongside with his mouth open without any fuss or anything, just proceeded in biting through the tope and swimming off with the lower half of the tope, just leaving me the head on the line. We just sort of both sat there in silence for a bit, sort of disbelief of what we'd just seen, but sure enough, on the end of my line was the tope and this big shark disappearing. Now we've both been out Paul Beagle fishing quite a few times before and caught them before, and we discussed the fact that this was too big, as far as we was concerned, to be a Paul Beagle. We had wondered if it had been a white shark. Later on in the press, all of a sudden the press was shouting white shark seen further down the coast. It made us think what a small boat we'd had to see a mouth that big.
Less than 2 weeks later, a few miles away, a lobster potter hauled up his pots and found a dead shark, answering the same description tangled in his ropes. The potter has asked not to be named, but I interviewed him, and his description of the dead shark precisely fits that of a great white. The jury is still out over whether we get great whites in our waters. In contrast, over 6 confirmed, proven hammerhead sightings and incidents have enabled this shark to be added to the British list as a rare visitor. Even the credible great white sightings are not supported by hard evidence. And until this evidence exists, the great white enigma will remain. If I had told my fellow passengers on the short crossing from the mainland to the Isle of Wight that I was visiting the island to make a film on sharks, they would probably have thought I was mad. However, in recent years, the island's waters have proved to be the British hotspot for thresher sharks, with an average of 20 being caught, tagged and released each year. Early the next morning and we're aboard Midnight Rambler, owned and skippered by Danny Vokins, who is one of the island's most experienced shark angling skippers. Here we see Danny in action with his magic coconut shell voodoo shark attractor. While we were waiting for the voodoo to work, I talked to Sarah Fowler, a keen angler who has come along for the trip. Sarah is also one of Britain's leading shark scientists and conservationists. I asked her how many thresher shark species there are.
There are 3 species in the world. 2 of them are fairly oceanic animals. One of those only occurs in the Pacific. So here in the Atlantic Ocean, we have 2.
And which one do we have around Britain?
British waters, we have the common thresher, which is the most coastal species of them all.
Why are we killing thresher sharks? What for?
Well, they have very large and very valuable fins. An awful lot of thresher fins go into the shark fin trade. It's something like between 2 and 6% of all the shark fins going through Hong Kong are thresher shark fins. And then they also have a fairly valuable meat. There have been some target fisheries just for thresher meat.
Threshers, paw beagles, makos and others have a counter-current heat exchange system. This enables them to maintain a constant body temperature higher than that of the surrounding sea. Being warm-blooded gives a distinct speed advantage to temperate water hunters.
When you think about it, here they are swimming around in the sea, warm-blooded animals giving birth to live young. They're just like mammals, really, except that they don't breathe air. They have gills. They're not really fish, they're sharks. That's something quite different, quite special.
At last, maybe we have some action. One of the floats kept disappearing under the water, so Danny brought the bait in to see what was going on.
Yeah, we've just had a bite on the one of the shark lines, and we brought it in. And as you can see here, we haven't got the slashes of teeth marks like you do on a tope. These are actually a small thresher's bite. You can tell by the... You just about make out the 2 rows of teeth marks which they leave when they actually bite into the fish. So we were just a bit unlucky there. I reckon that was a small thresher.
By the end of our second day, we had had blue skies, relatively flat seas, and possibly a thresher had been on our bait on the first day. However, we hadn't actually seen one, and we hadn't seen many mackerel either. Did Danny think the lack of mackerel and threshers were connected?
Oh, definitely. I mean, 3, 4, 5 years ago, I mean, the shoals out there were enormous. You know, they could be a mile long on the drift. You could drift 2 or 3 miles, and you'd be mackerel all the time. Nowadays, you know, if you can get 30 or 40 mackerel on a drift, I mean, we've done a 15-mile drift today, and we had, what, 25, 30 mackerel?
Yeah.
Not very good. And obviously, you know, that could be one of the reasons why we haven't had a thresher at the moment.
With a tail almost as long as its body, this shark moves with a unique grace. The Philippines, where this footage was shot, has become a magnet for tourists and filmmakers seeking thresher encounters. However, the largest thresher ever landed was caught in British waters. With an overall length of 10 metres, this 510-kilo, 80-stone giant is pictured here in November 2007 in New Lynn Market, where it was landed having become entangled in fishing nets. In June 1981, Danny was involved in a bizarre incident when fishing for threshers on board his friend Ross Staplehurst's boat. They were circled by a large shark that wouldn't take the bait. It almost seemed to be stalking them. Maybe it was, because with no warning, the shark leapt out of the water and landed in the boat with them. They tried to lift it over the side and back into the water, but the shark was too heavy and that huge tail too dangerous. With sadness, they were forced to kill the shark to ensure the safety of those on board. The forecast for our third day was not promising and proved to be accurate. The blue skies are gone, the wind is getting up, and the sea is getting rougher by the minute. After three sharkless days, the bad weather of summer 2008 reasserted itself and we were forced to return to shore. On our way in, we watched the helicopter and lifeboats racing to rescue a small craft caught out by the suddenly worsening weather.
To contact Solent Coast Guard urgently on VHF channel 16.
We had always presumed that filming free-swimming threshers in UK waters would be our most difficult challenge. The fact that in the end we were beaten this year by the weather has only strengthened our resolve to keep trying until we succeed. Day four was also a washout, so we didn't get our footage. But Danny is a keen photographer and videographer, and he invited me round to his house to look at film of his thresher encounters from previous years. Scientists and conservationists acknowledge that the tagging of sharks by sports anglers can provide data which can have important conservation benefits for sharks. All those we worked with making this film follow catch and release policies. Danny and his family have been catching threshers of all sizes off the Isle of Wight for the last 20 years, and as anglers consider them the most challenging sharks. Apart from extraordinary occurrences, like the unfortunate shark that jumped into the boat, they follow a no-kill policy. In summer 2007, Danny hooked what he estimated was at least a 500-pound thresher. This would have been a British record. But to claim the record, Danny would have to have killed the shark to weigh it. He chose to release the shark and off-swam his record. I'm delighted he made this decision, and certainly actions like this go a long way in defending shark angling against its critics. The blue shark seen at the start of this film often appeared relaxed and laid back. This is a porbeagle shark. It's like a Ferrari and rarely looks relaxed or laid back. Porbeagles are found all around our coasts, and these warm-blooded, close relatives of the great white are our largest commonly encountered predatory shark. It's probably wrong to have favourites, but I do, and these are my favourite British shark. Living in North Cornwall, they're on my doorstep, and I take every opportunity to go looking for them whenever conditions are right. Dunnet Head is mainland Britain's most northerly point. Sheer cliffs fall into the water where the Atlantic meets the North Sea. The water almost seems squeezed between the mainland and the Orkneys, and cod, herring and others use this connecting marine corridor. Prey means predators, and large porbeagles hunt these waters. The little port of Scrabster, to the southeast of Dunnet Head, is home to the man who landed the world's largest rod-caught porbeagle. That blue-hulled vessel is the Caron, the boat Chris Bennett was on when he caught his massive 36-stone, 230-kilogram world record shark. Chris believes this area offers the best porbeagle angling in Britain. I asked him why he thought that was so.
I think the Pentland Firth is like a motorway with its tides and the fact it connects the Atlantic to the North Sea, like a motorway for fish. And you could imagine any large predator sort of cruising and calling in at, you know, Dunnet Head, like a service area for a snack en route, and there's a huge traffic of fish through there.
The interview with Chris was interrupted when an unexpected predator turned up to audition for the film. This wannabe film star showed he wasn't at all camera shy, but he lost interest when we told him Chris already had the starring role. The photo shows Chris with his world record shark. It's a sturdy, large girth shark, which measured just under 10 foot in length. Chris told me the story of its capture.
We were literally just getting ready to pack up. And as is often the way with, you know, any large predator, particularly sharks, just as the light's going, this fish came out of nowhere and hit a bait right at the side of the boat, sending spray over everyone.
So you saw the shark?
So we knew it was a big one. And then we had to sort of really, it was at the turn of the tide, the air was starting to run, and we then had to deal with worsening conditions, you know, lifting swell and quite a heavy tide, until we actually got the shark tied up, I think an hour and 20 minutes later.
The epic struggle between Chris and the shark was watched over by Dunnet Head and its lighthouse. The photo we showed earlier of the net caught possible great white was also taken under these towering cliffs. There's something about these waters that doesn't make it surprising there are large sharks here. From time to time, cameras attached to North Sea rigs have got fleeting glimpses of sharks. Sometimes the media have acquired these images and the great white shark hue and cry is off once again. These examples of such footage were filmed by robotic cameras beneath North Sea oil and gas platforms. At the end of our time in Scotland, we heard reports of a poor beagle in difficulties, which had been filmed in Fishguard Harbour. This sent us back to Wales on the trail of another story. Sharks' dorsal fins this close to shore in Britain usually means basking sharks. For this poor beagle to be behaving like this meant something was wrong. Cliff Benson of the Sea Trust witnessed and filmed the incident and told us the story.
And we'd had a report that there were bottlenose dolphins feeding at the harbour entrance. So we grabbed our film equipment and we shot down to the harbour entrance and started filming the bottlenose dolphins. That was going great. And then I got a phone call to say that there are also common dolphins actually within the harbour. So we finished with the bottlenoses, rushed back down to the other side of the harbour by the main road there. When we got there, there was actually a group of people looking at, shouting dolphin, but actually looking at what was pretty obviously a shark.
This shark is disorientated and in trouble. It looks dazed and lost, and is not sure which way to go to get back out to sea.
Wow! Wow, wow, wow! Well, that ain't no basking shark. That's a poor beagle, I think.
Cliff explains some of the theories as to what might have happened to this shark.
When I filmed that, I noticed these red blotches on its snout and on its head, and I thought it was abrasions, I thought it was blood or something. But I later found out, I talked to the lifeboat guys around here, and they'd seen it earlier in the day, and they'd gone out in a rib to see what it was and found it was a shark. And they tried to tow it out of the harbour thinking it was disorientated. But they grabbed hold of the dorsal fin and tried to pull it, and obviously it didn't like that much, and so it and gone. But they did say that the red blotches were there already, and they think probably it had come into the harbour at this side where the ferry is, and probably just bumped into the ship, the Stena Europea, which is the big ferry, which is covered in red, an almost liquid jelly sort of anti-fouling paint, and that was what was on it.
We will never know for sure what did happen, but the shark found its way back out to sea and was never seen again. Our journey ends in Cornwall, where it began. 2007 and 2008 were the first 2 years of a 5-year poor beagle research, filming and photographic expedition carried out by the Shark Conservation Society. The aims of the expedition were to achieve 3 firsts: to deploy the first satellite tags on poor beagles in British waters, to obtain the world's first good quality free swimming footage of these sharks, and lastly, to get the first good quality photos, again, of free swimming sharks. trying to do what hasn't been done before needs both luck and imagination. Before either can play their parts, we need sharks, and that means chumming, as it did for the blue and thresher sharks. It doesn't matter how many times I do this, the excitement when the first fin breaks the surface never diminishes. On previous occasions when I had tried to get into the water with these sharks, they disappeared. For this reason, we used a pole cam to get our first footage, and it worked. We had achieved the first of our objectives. Having got footage safely in the can, I could try again to get into the water with them. I wanted to work out how to do this, to try and give poor beagles a British ecotourism potential, as I had done with blue sharks. Let no one say these sharks don't have a sense of humour. As soon as I got into the water and swam out to the bait tubes, the sharks disappeared. I would wait a while, then swim back to the boat, and they would reappear. Now, after this had happened 5 or 6 times, I got the distinct impression they were laughing at me. With the footage and photos captured, we could move on to our next objective, satellite tagging poor beagles for the first time in our waters. We used circle hooks to avoid deep hooking and make hook removal easier. One of the prices paid for this is that hooked sharks are lost, but the welfare of the sharks makes it a price worth paying. If satellite tags are not fixed properly, they pop off early, which is a waste of time and money and means the shark has been stressed and put at risk for nothing. To get good fixes, I inboarded larger sharks than I would have done with non-electronic tagging. However, the team are all experienced and all tagged sharks were back in the water in only just over our 2-minute target and swam off strongly. We deployed 4 tags, variously set to pop off after 30, 60 and 90-day periods. The yellow dot shows the tagging location and the red dots show where the tags surfaced. Scientists are analysing the results, which will add to our scant knowledge of poor beagles. Because they're good to eat, the demand for poor beagle meat is high. Overfishing to meet this demand has led to the poor beagle being listed as critically endangered in the northeast Atlantic. At the end of 2007, for the first time, total allowable catch levels for poor beagles were set by the European Union. Catch limits have reduced the supply but not the demand. And this blood trail evidenced a poor beagle that had been caught by an unlicensed operator and then dragged up the steps on its way to a waiting vehicle and the black market. The European Union made more moves in the right direction at the end of 2008. Poor beagles and spur dogs benefited from further reduced catch levels and new limits on maximum landing sizes intended to protect their breeding populations. We've got lots of new ideas for filming and getting close to poor beagles. So far, they've been too fast for me. It's become like a duel now, and I can't wait to try out new ideas. Even if I don't get really close to them, it'll be fun trying, great just to see the sharks, and the duel will go on. They're more than worth the effort, and I would hate to let them down by not giving them new human antics to laugh at each year. Poor beagles were abundant decades ago, but today they're relatively rare. This rarity, together with their shyness and speed, makes them difficult to film. You are watching the best, most extensive poor beagle footage currently in existence. One day, a great white shark may be confirmed in British waters, but until that happens, the poor beagle will remain Britain's own version of the great white shark.
It's been a real blast bringing you face to face with some of our sharks. We've had a great time and we've come across some wonderful people and some amazing sharks. With some 30 species in our waters, we've only scratched the surface. Blue sharks off Cornwall, basking sharks off Scotland, threshers around the Isle of Wight, poor beagles, soupfin sharks, spur dogs and cat sharks. I hope we've done justice to these fabulous animals. Making this film has shown us how little is documented on sharks in British seas. So this film is just the beginning. We've got lots more to discover and lots more to film. I hope
that as well as introducing our sharks, we've made clear who eats who, that sharks are under much greater threat from us than we are from them. Most of our shark species are officially categorized as being under threat. The angel shark has already been declared extinct in the North Sea. Extinct is a chilling word. It's forever. There's no reprieve. The waters around the British Isles are home to a rich diversity of marine life, including our sharks. The extinction clock is minutes from midnight for many species. We all need to work together to stop it and secure the future for our whole marine environment.